Okay, welcome to League of More. I'm by myself, just like I was at school a lot. This is League of More for another episode. Gavin Payne, not with us. He's at the coast getting a beautiful tan. And that's what he says, because it was actually the reunion of the 1991 Grand Final side who were here last Sunday at Totally Workwear Stadium. Tonight's show, we've got John Buchanan and also my favourite player in the Tigers outfit is Bennett Leslie. And for with Mark Gliddon from the Colts, we've also got James Busby, the number six. A good win over Wynnum last weekend, so we're going to talk to him. And we also had Jayda Lofipo, who plays for the BHP women's side, who didn't do a TikTok, unfortunately. But we also spoke to Luke Harlen. He is the wellbeing officer here at Totally Workwear Stadium, and he's the man who has the job of looking after our young men and women here at the club. And also, Gavin Payne, as I mentioned, he had a great chat and with Steve Ricketts, and we'll be seeing part two of that one as well. So stay tuned for League of More. It's going to be a cracker. Okay, welcome to League and More. And when we say League and More, we're not just talking about what happens on the park as well, but we've got Luke Harlen here. He is the welfare officer. Luke, first of all, I suppose, how did you get involved in rugby league and what you do?
Initially, I used to play. So I've always played since I was 5 or 6 years old. Done a bit of coaching. And then once I finished footy, I wanted to get back involved with the club. And the welfare and wellbeing was just starting to kick off, I guess, when I was looking to get into that. And I was lucky enough to get trained up and get a certificate. And Brian put me through all that stuff and trained me up. And here I am, yeah.
So when we talk about wellbeing, obviously, it's got nothing to do with nutrition or anything like that, because otherwise I could do a little bit of help myself. But when it comes to in this 21st century, the pressures on young men these days, not only on the football field, but off the field, how they, and they've got spare time, must be something that's a bit of a trigger sometimes for these guys?
Yeah, well, we're pretty lucky in the Queensland Cup, or in our comps, the blokes don't have much time.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier for them, you know.
But is that harder, though, because they're trying to be really good at footy and really good at their job, and they're trying to make ends meet with money, and they're trying to make ends meet and be a good football player. So that's another trauma in itself.
100%, yeah. It's really challenging. Yeah, they've got work, family, footy commitments. They're nearly training as much as NRL players anyway. So that's a real juggling act, and something that we need to be mindful as coaches and wellbeing people, that players all have different challenges. So, yeah.
All right, so what you do is basically – Your door's always open. It's confidential. If you've got a player or a player needs to talk to you, nobody else needs to know about it.
Yeah, correct. I'm like a first point of call. If anyone's got a problem, they see me around the club, they know me, I've got relationships with everyone. Hopefully they'll come to me. But, we have players looking out for players. We have coaches looking out for players. Everyone in the club is looking out for each other. So there could be signs, or it could be, someone come to me and say, my mate's not coping with something, and then I'll go to that player and ask how he's going and if I can do anything.
It's not so much, not just footy, is it? It's just in general life of men in particular. We have Are You Okay Day and all that sort of stuff, but in particular, men and young men just don't open up as much as they should be doing. And something, I'm in my middle 50s, is something we never talked about when we were young. We had any problems or any concerns. We really had nobody to go to. This is outstanding what the club offers for these young blokes. There's I'm not saying there's no excuse, but there's an option, and there's always someone to talk to confidentially, and we can get stuff sorted.
That's right, yeah. I think with the younger people come through, it is kind of changing. With that stereotype of blokes not talking. I think it is getting better. We've still got a long way to go. But, it's good having, nearly every club's got a wellbeing and education person these days. And I think it's really important because there's a lot of pressure on kids, I guess, with social media and stuff like that. So it's really important that people know who to go to when they have a problem.
Good. I'm glad you mentioned social media. It is a bane of our existence. Yes, social, it can be good for you, but cyberbullying and all that sort of stuff. You're obviously dealing with the 16s and ups, young men as well. So do you find a lot of angst amongst social media, amongst some of the young blokes?
Yeah, not so much. They'll say they have a problem because they don't really know that it's affecting them, I guess, because they've grown up with social media and mobile phones. It's hard for them to pinpoint that it's causing them a problem. So that's probably one of the hardest things we have to deal with is the reality of life is different to what they see on social media and on their phones.
Mm. I'm guessing you need to have what I don't have, and that's good hearing. You need to be able to listen to what these guys are saying and putting in front of you, I suppose. You're there to listen. You're not there to judge or anything like that. You're a go-between man to help these guys get on the right path, hey?
Yeah, that's 100% correct. Most of the time, you know, they just want to talk to someone
yep.
and get their problems off their chest, and that might all be it. And that can just, you know, take the weight of the world off their shoulders just by talking to someone about their problems. You know, it could be anything, family or, you know, footy or
yep.
not getting a run or anything. So it just helps having someone to talk to that they trust. And then, you know, if I can't sort it out, if we need someone more professional, then we pass them on to someone else, yeah.
All right. And very rude of me, female players exactly the same?
Female players exactly the same, yeah.
Because they've got a lot more to juggle, I suppose, with I know there's some players actually have children as well. I mean, I know a lot of the male players have children as well, but they you could probably find that most female players want to get away from the kids so they don't kill them. They want to go out there and play yeah. hard footy, but it's open, obviously, for under-19 girls. We've got in that competition, we've obviously got the BHP women's as well, so that's another whole new dynamic, isn't it?
It is a new dynamic, yeah, and it's something that we have to get on top of pretty quickly. Yeah, there is different things that, I guess, affect women compared to men, which we all know, and that is one of them having kids and,
yeah.
you know, finding babysitters and stuff like that, which we need to think about and... you know, I guess get better in the future with that stuff.
All right. Look, when I say there's obviously confidentiality and all that sort of stuff, how do they get in touch with you? It's just a case of they've got your number, it's completely confidential, nobody needs to know that you guys have chatted or anything like that. Is that how it works?
Yeah, my number's normally plastered around in the sheds or...
Yep.
Most, you know, I introduce myself at the start of the season. Mm-hmm. I'm nearly at every training session, so the boys know me. You know, I'm just hanging around. I'm, I guess, like a presence, so the guys do know me, and then hopefully if there is a problem, they will come to me.
All right. Well, look, Harlen, he's the wellbeing officer. Look, don't hesitate. I mean, he's qualified. If he can't help you, he knows people who can. And really, fellas, it's not a weakness whatsoever to come up and just get somebody to talk. Luke will just listen to what you've got to say, and then hopefully you can help him out, or you can put him on the right pathway, mate. But it must be challenging yet rewarding for you as well, mate.
Yeah, I think I couldn't have said it better. It is challenging and rewarding. Yeah. And there's no judgment when people come to me, so I guess it's a bit nerve wracking. Going to tell people your problems, but you know, there's no judgment. You know, we're all should be, strong enough. Well, you know, you should be able to go and talk to someone about this stuff, and that's what we're trying to promote. Just go and tell your mate or tell someone, then they'll probably end up with me.
At the end of the day, it's one conversation could change your life, basically, couldn't it? Save your life.
Yeah.
Luke, mate, great chatting to you, mate. You've got a hell of a workload in front of you there. I appreciate what you do for the club and all the wellbeing guys around the place. But young blokes need, and women need your presence around. And please just reach out and Luke's there to listen and do what he can. All right, mate. Cheers.
No worries. Appreciate it.
More last weekend, the BHP team, the West Brisbane Panthers, came out and took on the Brisbane Tigers. And Jayda Lofipo, tough game, tough afternoon.
Yeah.
But you had a blinder of a game, I've got to say, because I called that game for Q+. Just not enough there. The Panthers just a little bit too more polished, maybe.
Yeah, they were really hard competition. They were a strong side. Didn't get the result we wanted, but we stuck it out to the end.
20 points to 14. So you almost had a chance at the back end of that game. You came back strong.
Yeah. We put up a fight to the end. We weren't going to surrender easily, but
Close to the line. I have no idea how they stopped you from quite a few times. Do you love that contest? And I've seen you almost run from where we are in Studio 33, running it back and live from the kickoff. Something stopping you? You love it.
No, yeah, it's great.
Got a smile on your face. It's a bit scary.
It's a bit scary, but no, it's great. Yeah.
And how did you end up playing rugby league?
Started under 14s at Redlands.
5 years
at a junior
ago.
Club. Yep. Just got into it with some girls from school.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So always played in the front row?
Yep.
Okay. All front rows are pretty good number sixes. You ever crank at number six, you reckon?
No.
You can do it.
No.
One thing also noticed, I think there's a little bit of a football exchange between the forwards out there in the middle of Total Workwear Stadium, which is always good to see forwards passing the football.
Yeah, you
don't need them, do you?
No.
They're getting in the way?
Yeah.
They're getting in the way. All right, wonderful. Burley, you got a bit of a touch-up. You had a win the following week here. You've only gone down 6 points to the Premiers of 2 years ago in the West Brisbane Panthers.
Yeah.
Things are looking better. You've got a lot of players out.
Yeah.
It was a real good character by your side, led by Taylor Eldridge, to get so close. So you must be really pleased, although you didn't get the points, really pleased with what you did out there.
No, definitely. Yeah, we definitely have improved from our Burley game. But it's just been great to, learn each week what we need to improve on.
All right.
Yeah.
What do you think you need to improve on?
My D, probably.
Okay.
Just getting up faster off the line is always a big
thing. What
about
your kicking game?
Kicking game? No. No kicking lessons.
No kicking lessons. I think you probably put a pretty good bit. I've seen Steph Hancock put a pretty big kick up there.
Yeah.
So I'll talk to Bowser. You've been in a couple of weeks. Hey, you're up against, you've got to go against Gold Stars in your next game, and they have only, I think they're sitting in third spot at the moment.
Yeah.
So you've got to fly up to Jack Mansky Oval.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking forward to the fly up there? You got to wear your mask, I believe, still.
Yeah, I think we do.
You looking forward to that?
Yeah, it should be good. I'm getting to fly down there with the girls. It should be good. Yeah.
Are you going to stay up there?
Yeah, we're staying up there, yeah.
Well, how many are going up and how many will come back is another story. Who don't you want to sit next to on the plane?
Probably, I don't know, Nelly. She probably talked my ear off.
How's her injury coming along? She's
good. No, she's done her ACL, so she won't be back for...
Is she going up with you guys?
I hope so.
Okay, all right. So only a certain number of players ago. Gold Stars, they'll see where you're at. You're away up at Jack Mansky. It could be quite warm conditions. Yourself up there in the nightlife up there, I believe you're pretty good at TikTok stuff.
Oh, no. Who told you that?
Nothing. So what we're going to do is we're going to move the chairs back. And you got a TikTok movie you want to do for us? That's okay.
No, I'm kidding.
I can't reveal who my source is, so listen,
okay.
You're a good sport. You're loving your rugby league. I love watching you carry the ball up here. And I think your D will come good. And when that comes good, I think it'll be a lot of crushed bone underfoot when you're out there in the middle of. Jayda, always a pleasure talking to the Tigers BHP women's side. And all best of the weekend.
Thanks, John.
Cheers.
Thank you.
All right, Legan Moore. Colts coach is Mark Gliddon. Gliddo, you asked for your side to get off to a better start, and they did that for you against the Seagulls last weekend.
Yeah, the first half was pleasing. We led 12-10 at halftime, completed at, I think it was about 84% in the first half, which was really helpful, actually. A bit of ball control, and I was quite pleased at halftime. And I think my message to the boys was, how long's the game of footy go for? And they said, 80 minutes, not 40. I said, that's right, we've done half a job and we need to get out there and have a crack. So
You knew they'd come back at you hard, but the first half, they were winning the ruck area and you called for that to be slowed down.
Yeah, we worked pretty hard on the ground. JB gets Bumper Farrell in to do a bit of stuff with the boys and the stuff he does floats down to the Colts. So we needed to work a bit harder in that area. We challenged our middle before the game and again at halftime and basically said, if the middle don't do their job, we're not going to win this footy game. And to their credit, our middle was really good on the weekend.
Halftime, as you said, the boys knew. Did you have to say much at halftime?
Oh, mate, a smart man many years ago told me not to say too much at halftime. You know, you probably give them four things and they might remember two. So
that's about
as far as it went.
Yeah, throughout the game, who stood out for you? What facet of the game was it? Your defence was outstanding.
Yeah, I thought we defended really well. You know, we leaked 22 points, but Wynnum are a fair footy team.
Yeah.
Like, no one's got near them this year, so... thought our goal line D can be a little better. I've got a bit of video on that tonight in a couple of little areas. We just need to stay squarer. But all in all, it was a pretty pleasing performance. Really impressed with big Joey Gilmore, our co-captain. I think he ran for 176 metres, which pretty good for a big man. And Solomon Fatafi, I think that's how you say his last name. Exactly. He ran for about 170-odd metres as well. So both them guys were quite impressive. And I have to give Simon Pratt a rap. Simon's been off for footy for a long time with an ACL injury, coming back from it two or three games back. And I had him do a job, and that was to get up there seven in Will Pasto. Yeah. And he did a really good job. He just went at him all day. And I think Will ended up making about 24, 25 tackles. So it was good.
Yeah, Will's a handy player. You know,
he's a good player.
You miss him and he goes.
We wanted to try and tire him out. Yep. And that's what we were trying to do. So.
All right then. You're up against the Mustangs next, I believe. So,
yeah.
That is, you've got a couple of weeks off. So are you happy for a bye? You've got momentum all of a sudden.
Oh, we've got a bit of momentum, but we've also got a few injuries out of that game on the weekend. Only some niggles. One's quite a serious injury. Young Justin Smith compound fractured his thumb, unfortunately. He told me he'd be back in 2 weeks. That's Justin. He's a tough little kid.
Yeah.
So, look, it's probably coming at a good time. And we've got 14 days off. Myself and JB are heading to Melbourne to do a bit of educational stuff with them. So that'll be really interesting. I'm really looking forward to that. And then we play Toowoomba in Toowoomba, which I think will be really tough. You know, they'd be big, tough country boys.
Yeah, all right, well, you're up to the task, and it's a good win there for the Colts side. What was it end up being, 32 points to 22? Not many sides get to put 32 points on the Seagulls.
No, that's true. Well, they've been really good this year. They're a good side. They're well coached, and they're going to get better because their 18s were quite successful this year. So them guys will jump up into that side. So it was a good win, good result. Right.
Just quickly, BRL TV, you got on the Cairns to commentate that game with Cameron Anker, and what a nail-biter it was against the Wynnum Manly junior side and the Carina side, which you'd have some players involved in that. 7 minutes and 35 seconds into the game, we had a result.
It was a cracking, there was a little bit of drop ball here and there, but other than that, because it was so close, it was a cracking game of footy. It was quite exciting, and I think Wynnum scored in the last 10 seconds to win the game. I think Kyle Coggle threw Tristan Hope a pass and he went over and broke Karina's heart, unfortunately.
Yeah. Well, I want to ask you about that. Is some of the your boys playing that?
No, mainly JB's boys,
okay.
Mainly the Cup boys. Most of my boys were in the 20s and there was maybe four playing in the BRL reserve grade.
Okay, so, all right, wonderful, mate. Great to see that everybody's getting to play some football. Listen, enjoy the 2 weeks off. What do you do to keep the boys up, so to speak, for with the four training runs you've got between now and Toowoomba?
Well, we're doing a bit of video tonight, and they're trained tonight, they're trained Thursday night. I'll give them the weekend off. They can do what they want to do on the weekend, and then we'll be back next Monday and next Tuesday, I should say. And the old saying, winning starts on Mondays, we'll be ready to go.
What are you going to do with the weekend off, Glitter?
I'm in Melbourne, so but I'll be back on
check pace free. I'll be age people.
I'll be back Saturday, Arvo, and straight to a 21st over at Davies Park. Couple of quarties.
Oh, Mark Gliddon, yes. Watch this space. This chair may be empty in 2 weeks.
Could be.
Listen, congratulations in all series, mate. Good win by the boys against a quality side. And, it was nothing better than having a home win here at Totally Workwear Stadium, mate. And all the best. And look forward to talking to you again soon, mate.
Cheers, mate. It was a great day. We're very well run. The club should be really pleased with the way the day went.
Exactly. Big crowds. Thanks, mate. Cheers. All right, the Colts had a win on the weekend, and their number six is with us, James Busby. James, good win. You've been building towards this, and I spoke to Mark Lynn about this a few times. You need to get away to a good start, and you did that.
Yeah, definitely. We we focused on getting three sets completed first, and we did that. So, yeah, just listen to what the coach said.
Oh, yeah? There you go. Lesson learned right there. Listen to what your coach says. But listen, what I want to ask you is, you're up against Wynnum, who've scored a lot of points, and I reckon it could have gone either way. Either they walked all over top of you, but you guys muscled up in the middle in particular, and you took it to the Seagulls, you took a lead in the Sheds, and you took it all the way to the 80-minute mark. So kudos to you guys. You must be pretty chuffed about all that.
Definitely. It was pretty good. We talked about it at training, just about how many points that they'd scored.
Yeah.
And we just got to muscle up and play for each other, really.
Mm. Completion rates are good?
Yeah, the completions were the best they've been all year. Yep. I think it was like 80% or 79%.
Yeah, they talk about it a lot. It's a pretty simple game, rugby. You hang on footy, they can't score.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. 32 points against them, so your attack was on fire as well?
Yeah, no, well, we just got to our points, did what we did at training, just Got taken points, completed, yeah, so it's not a hard game, really.
All right. You're the number six. Number 17, they do a bit of yapping. Are you a bit of a yapper behind the pack?
Yeah, definitely. Like, yep. I'll let Jonah kind of run the show, and when I want the ball, I'll call it, I guess, yeah.
All right, then. You stick to the game plan. Mark will be very happy with that. You've got a couple of weeks off now, so are you happy about that? Would you rather kept playing and taking momentum? Because you've been building nicely, haven't you?
Yeah, definitely. We've come from a few... We started with a loss, to another gritty win, and then to a probably our most comfortable win, I guess.
Yep.
Against a really good side, but I don't think it really makes a difference at all.
All right, you've got to go to Toronto and take on the Mustangs. It won't be easy. They're big. They, you know, antelope for breakfast. Those boys up there, so it's going to be a pretty tough ask. You happy with your form, mate?
Yeah, I am pretty happy at the moment. Just the coach gave me a few things he wants me to do on the game and improve on each week, and he said I've ticked a few of them off, so yeah, just got to keep improving, I guess.
All right, so you got to go to Toowoomba by bus. Who don't you want to be sitting next to on the bus trip up there?
There's definitely a few boys, but I'd probably say maybe Lewis Gibb.
Yeah.
He's not playing, but I just wouldn't want to see. He just talks too much.
Does he? Okay. Yeah. There is anybody who's just sort of a bit of flatulence or anything like that, or throws popcorn or anyone that you don't want up there?
Nah, I don't.
All right, so, but it'd be a sweet trip coming back from the range if you can get a win against.
Oh
those
yeah, guys. Definitely.
The next weekend you got off. What are you going to do? Stay away from footy? Or?
I'm not too sure. I might go back home for the weekend or just.
Oh, you're from Rocky.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Rocky. So.
All right then. So go up there and chill out there.
Maybe. Yeah.
Eat a bit of steak.
Yeah, that's it.
roast steak and everything else. All right, listen, so James Busby, congratulations on the weekend, mate. A great win. A couple of injuries, and hopefully when you come back against the Mustangs, you're all ready to go and roll on. But congratulations. That is a really good win against a really good side. So it is funny what happens when you listen to the coach and you guys are going on the, marching to the same beat, which is always good. You want to give a shout-out, Erna? The ex-girlfriend, anything like that?
Little brother, Charlie Busby.
There you go. Yeah, beautiful. That's it. All right, James, thanks for your time, mate. Cheers. Well, John Buchanan is the head coach of the Intrust Super Cup side. Last weekend, mate, good first half. Probably lost our way a little bit with the injury to Jared Beale, but up to that point, really solid stuff from the Tigers.
Yeah, obviously a disappointing finish to the game. Yeah, I thought we started really well. Had a little period there, probably 10 minutes before half time, which has probably been an area that we've struggled. I think we touched on it last week. We touched on it as a group, but we just we made probably three errors in that period and conceded a couple of tries. So, and I probably thought we should have gone in leading by a bit more if we were a bit better through that last 10 minutes of the first half. And then, second half, to be honest, obviously losing Billy didn't help us because he was pretty good in that first 25, 30 minutes. To Wynnum's credit, mate, they had us coming off our line for the majority of the second half. We had limited opportunities in good ball, and we were probably a little bit fatigued when we did get there, and we were pretty clunky and just couldn't come up with something.
The first 20 minutes or so, Aaron Penne, Aaron Booth, Will Samuel and Bennett Leslie dominated that game. I thought they were outstanding up the middle, and then that was able to give Darren Nichols the opportunity to kick wherever he wanted. I thought it was a methodical and well-planned game plan, especially at twilight to send the ball high, but he couldn't send it high without the work of those guys at the front.
Yeah, look, mate, our start was enough. We could start like that every week, but we just got to maintain it. At the moment, look, I know we're coming off two wins, but against a really good teams, you can't afford to have, 10-minute laps with back-to-back errors and then not defend them. And, that was the difference in the game. It was 4-3, and we just had a period there where we weren't good on both sides of the ball, and a good team like Wynnum made us pay.
You used the width of Totally Workwear Stadium again, like you did against the Bears there, and Aramea scores a couple of tries in the corner. And then obviously you had to reshuffle the back lines. They had Link Port out there, Michael Purcell comes back in here, made a break down the sidelines as well. So you had a lot of talent out there, a lot of speed. It's just trying to get them all in the right direction. Was that a little bit confusing with the change in the back line?
Yeah, like that's footy though, isn't it, mate? Like, we yeah, to be honest, we've been carrying an outside back on the bench the last few weeks, and we've probably got away with it. You know, Link started the game at fullback, and then we had to play him at six, obviously, when Jared got injured. So, look, Link did a really good job trying to, you know, like slotting there at the last minute when we needed him to. And, yeah, we just, mate, we just couldn't find a way through that. It was probably about a five-minute period with about 10 to go. We probably could have, you know, got hit the front, but we just couldn't get over the line, mate. And, yeah, I think defensively we defended our line really well in the second half. I know we conceded two tries, and one of those was fairly dubious, but it took a lot of gas out of us coming off our line a lot. So, yeah, mate, the good teams, they'll make you pay, and they're a really good footy side. And I said to our guys, you know, after the game, look, if we want to be a, you know, a really good team moving forward, we got to win more of those games than we lose. So
you're not allowed to say it, but I'm going to say it. I thought a couple of the decisions were really outstandingly pretty ordinary, especially in that first half. So, I mean, you've got to adjust to that. It's going to happen. Sometimes it comes back and it helps you out. It's maybe no excuse, but it makes it really tough after you've done all the hard work to probably have a couple of those decisions that probably didn't go your way. Sometimes they bounce up at the end of the day, but it didn't happen. Dan Russell, on debut, had a great game across the chalk. He would have been, well, he would have been happy at halftime, but obviously not at full-time, but he had a good start.
Yeah, he was solid. He sort of just did his job.
Yep.
You know, he's still, he went to Melbourne for a pre-season, got an injury down there, sort of 5 weeks into that, and he's been back obviously with us now for probably, you know, 7 or 8 weeks, but he's only really been back doing full training the last 3 or 4 weeks. So, yeah, look, he's a quality player. He's going to get better. Yeah. You know, I know he was solid the other night, but he can be a lot better than that. Right. So, and hopefully we'll get to see that over the next month or so.
Hunters next in 2 weeks' time, down the coast. You love the water, mate, down there to Runaway Bay. It won't be easy. They had a loss, so they'll be a little bit cranky. But you got 2 weeks off. Are you happy with that 2 weeks off?
Yeah, look, we've probably got a few bumps and bruises. Yep. We've had, that was a pretty tough game. And all our data from our sports scientists, not that I'm a data man, but, you know, they're all telling us that that was the hardest game we've played this year physically, and each player's playing load as well. So, look, the break's probably come at a fairly good time just to freshen a few guys up and get ready for the Hunters in 2 weeks' time.
They don't come any harder than the Hunters, mate.
No, it doesn't matter.
It's going to be tougher again.
They just keep coming. All day.
All right, mate. Listen, a lot to learn from that game there, but obviously it's Jared Beal. Not a bad injury. Hopefully he may be back. That'll benefit him having that extra week off, and maybe we might see him against the Hunters.
Yeah, and I think...
Give him too much away?
No, I think he'll be fine. He just had a little twinge in the hammy, and probably without, you know, turned into a 6-week injury, we just had to get him out of there. So, I think he'd be fine to go.
Yeah. When was the last time you twinged at hammy, mate?
I'll never twinge. It
just comes off the bone. But anyway, yeah. JB, all the best, mate. Weekend off next weekend. You looking forward to that? A bit of a break from the footy?
Yeah, I'm off to Melbourne actually tomorrow. So, looking forward to that. Get an opportunity to get down there and see how they do things. And,
You're taking Gliddon with you?
Yeah, taking Mark with us. So, we'll be down there for 4 days or so, and hopefully be a good experience.
Well, maybe they'll both come back. We'll see you. Jamie, all the best for the weekend, mate. Thanks for your time on the League More, and enjoy the weekend down in Melbourne, and I'm sure it'll be a blast, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks.
No worries.
Last weekend, Anzac Day weekend, big crowd here at Totally Workwear Stadium, and we had the minutes sold and everything like that to start the game. Every year now, the Anzac Day medal will go to the best Tigers player on ground, and that is going to be presented in honour of Mari Power, who is the mother of Greg McDonald, who's on the board here. The three sons, Mari's three grandsons, they all pick their selection for the best player in that game. And good on all three boys. They all picked different ones, so I'm not really sure who had the casting vote on that. But last year, Patrick Cafusi won it, and this year it was awarded to Aaron Booth for his efforts as well. So, a big thank you to to Greg for that, and he his oldest son Stephen joined the army back in 2016 when his mum was so proud when he went to Kapuka to watch his graduation ceremony. So army's in the family, and that's why the Anzac Day medal then was presented last weekend. And well done to Aaron Booth. Every year they'll be presented. We thank Greg and family for all that. So well done. Cheers. My pleasure, actually. Ever since I've seen this man play footy, I've actually loved the way he plays rugby league. His name is Bennett Leslie. And last weekend, you whacked on the number 13 jersey, mate. Lock or prop, where do you prefer?
I don't really care, man. It doesn't bother me at all. I'll play anywhere.
You'll play anywhere?
Yeah.
Number 6?
Yeah.
Well, okay, cool. Hey, great start against the Wynnum Manly side last week. Yourself, Aaron Penne, Aaron Booth, Will Samuel. The four of you had a great start to the game. That gave Darren Nichols good field position to get those high balls in the air. Mm-hmm. Did you feel like you were on top of that pack?
I thought we were there for that first 30 and all that. And then I noticed momentum changes in the game. It always ebbs and flows. And you got to ride it when it's good and then hold on when it's bad. But I just feel like in that last 10 in the first half, we kind of let ourselves lapse a little bit there. And that's things we need to work on. We've had chats after the game and even this morning with our forwards and the halves and everything in areas that we can work on, and I reckon we can definitely pick it up and fix that.
What did you come away from that you did so well against Burley?
Well, Burley are a big forward pack. They always love their forward game.
Yep.
And we know that we had to out-muscle them in the middle, I guess, and just try and give it to them as hard as we could to blow them out, to stop their go forward. And
you did that to a degree against Wynnum Manly.
Against Wynnum, yeah, definitely. And then I think... I don't know if we got complacent or how we really say for it, but we kind of let it off a little bit and they just kind of come home like a steam train, and then, the scores show the rest of it, but, something we can work on.
The first half, as I said, there's a lot of good forward up the front there, sort of from the front row. There's a little, obviously when Jared Bill went off there, obviously the back line had to readjust to a degree, so as forwards, you don't worry about what they're doing, you stick to what you guys are planning, or do they change the game plan a little bit more?
No, we just...
the back three.
Yeah, well, with the forwards, we just can control what we can control. Yeah. The edges, obviously, they have to adjust to what's going on there, but, we can only try and do our job, which is go forward and slow down the ruck when we're in D. But apart from that, the backs have got all the control of that stuff.
Tough game?
Yeah, very tough game. Old boys' day, and...
Yeah.
Anzac round always gets everyone pumped up for it, and
big crowd too.
Yeah, it was good having everyone here. Good crowd,
So you're up against the PNG Hunters, doesn't get any easier. I know they're not as high on the ladder as the Seagulls, but those guys, they'll leave bruises on parts of your body. You didn't know had parts on your body that could be bruised.
Literally. It's like tackling a fridge with legs most times.
Unless it's full of beer, of course, but yeah. So do you know much? Have you played the PNG Hunters?
Yeah, I played him a few times over my time in the Queensland Cup. I was lucky enough to play him down in Sydney. Against him in Sydney when I was at South.
Yep. And was that in the final?
Sorry?
Was that in the final on Grand Final Day? Was that for the challenge?
Oh, no, this was years ago in the return to Redfern.
Oh, okay, right.
And, they haven't changed. They're still ridiculously tough players. I take my hat off to them every time I play against them. Like, you're in for a fight. They're always a great side.
They're a little bit unpredictable in their back line, but forward play is generally forward play. You just got to run hard and fast and that. Do you get dirty when you get called off? Are you happy to have a break, or do you rather play the 80?
I'd rather play the 80. I blow up.
Yeah. It's harder to get back on after you have it. Yeah, exactly right.
I've said that every time I've come off. I look at JB or MC and I'm like, what are you doing? Leave me on.
I've got plenty more. I'll play some number 6. I've done that before. It's no dramas at all. Yeah. How are you joining here at the Tigers, mate?
Yeah, I love this. This is my third season here. Yeah. I loved it. I've had mates previously play at the club when I was watching on for years, living down in Sydney and even in Mackay, and they've always given the club good raps and said how much they've loved it, and I can see why.
Yeah.
It's a very family club, and they always take care of the boys, so got nothing to fight against them.
Is it a burden for you to be known as the best looking forward in the pack with the
Tom? It is hard, but that's my cross to bear. I just got to do what I can do, I guess. Yeah.
Is there a lot of product on the nightlife?
On the nightlife? In this?
Or salad?
I'd just say a hard hat helps, a lot of sweat. It's got really nowhere to go. That's pretty much it, no product.
So if you had to pick four others to make up the village people, who would it be?
Oh, you good.
Who would be the tradie?
The tradie, I would probably have to pick Frizy.
Frizy.
I'd put...
Frizy doesn't put his clothes on a lot, does he?
No, that's Dorney.
Oh, is it?
Dorney hats around a shirt. I think he's allergic to it, or he doesn't own one.
Right. We could talk about this all day, but yeah. Ben and Leslie, I love watching you play rugby league, mate. I do believe you're the way you bring the ball back into the line there is it lifts the rest of the forward pack here. There's a couple of young players in there in Will Samuel as well. Frizy, Jack Peoples, you've got players coming off the bench here in Jordan Grant, Brett Greinke. There's a lot of talent there, so I'm guessing you've really got to make sure you don't give those suckers an even break and keep your starting spot.
Yeah, all the names that you just said, they're all starting players in the Q Cup. Since my time here, they've either playing against them or with them, they've always been in the starting forward pack. It keeps all of us on our toes because we know that there is someone good that is there ready to go. Okay. And if we don't perform, we'll lose our spot. But in saying that, the environment at the club at the moment is team first, and we're all worried about, like, you know, what's best for the team is what's good for us. So we just want everyone to push and be better.
Terrific. Are you still on the nudie run, or are you across?
No, I'm still on it. Willie Samuels stole one from me and sat it down in booth. So,
Doesn't count, I'm sorry.
Oh, I know.
Two halves don't make it. No need.
There's still a long season to go, so there's still a hope.
All right. Maybe when he's playing number six. Ben Lizzie, I love the way you play rugby league. Be a tough encounter against the PNG Hunters, mate. But all the best. And, look, good luck with that burden you've got to carry, mate. It's a credit to you that you're just a humble and a proud man.
Yeah, that's it, mate. Oh, do what you do.
Good. Rolling up here. Thanks. Yeah, welcome back to League and More. I've joined this afternoon by Steve Ricketts, esteemed journalist as well. I had a chat to one of your colleagues, probably John McCoy, last week, and it's great to have you in the chair, Steve. Welcome.
Thanks very much, Gavin. Yes, I've had a lot to do with Macca, John McCoy. I'm chairman of the Queensland Rugby League History Committee, and John's on the committee with me.
Okay, terrific. It's good to maintain those relationships like we do in our rugby league careers, in the journalism careers as well. It's very similar.
Yeah, well, I was on his radio TAB show for quite a few years, and Macca is a wealth of knowledge on the game of rugby league, and of course was honoured in the recent Australia Day Awards.
Yes, absolutely. Now, you mentioned Macca as well. We talked to him a little bit at the start of the interview last week about how he got his start, where he got started in the journalism career. So let's tell us a little bit about your career.
Well, I was editor of the school newspaper at Wollumbah High, and I was always going to be a journalist. When I left school, I had an offer of an ABC scholarship in Brisbane or a cadetship on the local paper, the Daily News.
Right.
And I was a bit of a homeboy, so I took the cadetship at the local paper and continued to play rugby league, but I had to actually cover the games in which I played, which meant that I was a bloke who never had a bad game. And
won several Man of the Match awards as well, I might imagine.
So, I really enjoyed working in a bush paper, but then I came up here to Brisbane in 75 and joined the Telegraph, the old afternoon paper, and in 81 I switched over to the sports department from the general section.
Okay. You covered rugby league, obviously, extensively. Were there any other sports that were involved there, or what were the other sections of that career that you covered?
In the 80s, I covered a fair bit of cricket, test matches, Shield finals, but once the Broncos came on the scene, effectively rugby league became a year-round sport. And essentially from 1988 onwards, when the Telegraph closed and I joined the Courier Mail, I was covering rugby league.
Okay. You mentioned you worked with John McCoy. Other esteemed people that you worked with as well over your career?
Yeah, well, I had the honour of covering a number of kangaroo tours, and I covered with people like Peter Frelingos, the late Chippy from the Mirror in Sydney, Ray Chesterton. Rex Mossop was on that particular trip. But at the Courier Mail, of course, Paul Malone, who passed away recently. Paul was a colleague of mine for many years, and it was a real honour to work with him. Robert Crash Craddock, who everyone knows.
Yes.
You know, the list of journalistic colleagues is long, and I'm just so happy to have worked with so many great people.
Fantastic, mate. You mentioned the kangaroo tours. You've obviously went on several of those. They're not so frequent anymore as they were in the past years. Favourite moments or memories from those tours?
Well, you can't beat the 82 kangaroo tour because it was the first time the Australian team went through Britain and France undefeated.
Yep.
And the style of football they played was just amazing. It really opened up eyes over there. You had rugby union coaches coming from the south of England to have a look at the kangaroos because they just revolutionised the way rugby league was played. And you'd been over there in 79 with the Australian schoolboys, of course. And I don't know, I think you played most of your games in France. And
Correct.
Rugby league in France was just starting to go on the downhill run then, but rugby league in England was still very strong, but they hadn't caught up to Australian methods. And they just thought they could still beat us by playing the old style footy in the rucks, and their skill would get them by, but they just weren't up to the same fitness levels of the Australians. And as I say, that tour with you know, people like Mal Meninga running rampant and Wally Lewis not able to make the starting team, it was amazing.
Yeah, terrific. Great memories. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, the 82 tour was the famous one where Mal bumped him off from his own 20-metre line and gave it to Ricky. Was that the
deciding test? That was in 1990, and and actually I had a supporters tour on that occasion.
On that one, yeah.
Because Paul Malone covered that tour for the Courier Mail.
Yep.
So I took a group of people from Brisbane on that trip, a lot of them from East, actually. One of the most famous coaches here, Lenny Conroy, came on
Mr.
the trip.
Mr. Conroy, yes.
And he was the life of the party. Brian Smart and his wife, Elaine. We also had Athol and Neryl Nielsen, because Scotty Nielsen, who you played with.
Yes, yes.
He's their son. So most of the people came from East and Souths.
And
we had a great time. We were in the grandstand at Old Trafford for that test match.
What a great memory that would be. That was one of the highlights of my memory of kangaroo tours, you know, sitting up at 2 o'clock in the morning watching the games being broadcast, and to see that Big Mal bumping them off and then Ricky taking over, or Ricky's taking over and then Big Mal getting to the trial. Terrific memories. You've covered the league for a long time. You've seen it back in the pre-NRL days through the NRL changes that happened in the Brisbane Rugby League competition, obviously affected by that, right through to the current NRL competition. What changes have you witnessed over that period?
They're enormous, actually, and you know, the degree of professionalism, obviously, in the clubs, right from the playing ranks down through the administration. Certainly, one part I haven't enjoyed in the new professionalism is the lack of access to the players. Everything's micromanaged now. In the old days, as you'd remember, journalists were allowed in the dressing rooms. Yes. We even interviewed you blokes in the showers.
Yes.
Whereas now you've got to ask a media manager to bring someone out to you. And a lot of the enjoyment, I mean, I'm glad I'm not directly involved with the media anymore, because I think the romantic days are gone, but I'm probably regarded as an old fart saying that. But, you know, to me the game is still the best game of all, but I still enjoy the footy played back in the 80s in particular, and even the 70s. I grew up in the 70s and I played rugby league in the 70s, and it was a pretty violent era. I remember I played a reserve grade game here at Langlands Park, and Bobby Arnold got me with an elbow and needed about six stitches above the eye, and you had to learn how to duck back in those days. But in some ways, I think the footy then was not as dangerous as it is now, because the gang tackling now just horrifies me. You know, the way the body is bent mangled, you know, in four-man tackles is just ridiculous.
And the power of the players, I think, these days too, has just come enormous way. Obviously, with everyone, I was talking to some friends here yesterday when we had a bit of a reunion and an old boys' day, talking about, you know, the one-on-one tackles that you used to make, and you'd get bounced straight up, and there was none of the wrestling and just the strength and conditioning coaches. We had Johnny Lang was coach. You know, we had a skills coach and a kicking coach who was new, and Lange introduced those sorts of things to the game. And I was talking to our kicking coach yesterday, Graham McComb, and he actually went on to be a kicking coach at the Broncos. Yeah. But to him, he was the first, as far as he's aware, the first kicking coach involved with the rugby league. So, you know, strength and conditioning, they've got, instead of three or four people now, they've got, you know, hordes of people that give them all this information and the strength, and they've got a diet and all that sort of stuff. Would never have floated in our days, unfortunately, Steve. Our diet was six beers in the dressing room after the game and away we went.
Well, that's what I look forward to after a game was having a beer. Even as a journalist, you know, you'd walk into the dressing room and most clubs would offer you a can of beer as you walked in, and there was a sense of camaraderie then that probably doesn't exist now. But it was funny you talk about food before a game. I read a book. The first rugby league book I ever read was Inside Rugby League by Ian Walsh, the former Australian captain, and he said on the day of a game he would eat a meal of T-bone steak and lettuce. So that was my pre-game meal. I thought if it was good enough for Ian Walsh, it's good enough for me.
Yeah. And did it work?
Well, put it this way, I played 80 minutes most times, but I'm sure there would have been better food to eat.
Yep. Of course, we're in Tiger country now. The Brisbane Tigers, as they're now known. You've covered many of those games over the years as well. You mentioned being involved in an incident here, but other other thoughts and interests and memories of Tigers over the years?
Well, it's funny, I met Larry Brigginshaw just the other day at Emerson Park. Yep. His daughter, Ali, was playing for Valleys, yep. And I went over and said good day to him. And, of course, he was captain in 83 when the Tigers yes. won the Premiership. And I covered that game, and I also covered that game in 91, yep. where you guys had yep. your reunion yesterday. Yep. And the footy, a lot of people just think when the Broncos came on the scene in 88 that that was the end of the BRL. The footy in the BRL was still quite strong, yes. and the crowds for the first few years for the grand finals were still a good five-figure amount, you know, 10,000-15,000. And the games between Easts and Valleys, Easts and Wests in particular, you know, Paul Green v. Adrian Lamb, yeah. you know, that was quality stuff. And I always remember Brad Thorne, you know, who went on to become one of the legends in both rugby codes, saying to me that playing with Wests, for instance, helped make him because yeah. he was playing with tough, hard men. And, yep. you know, he said that was a great grounding for him. And you know, I covered some of the tough times for East. So I remember in 87 when Shane McNally yes. was coach and the Tigers got the wooden spoon. And I think the Tigers had a habit of pulling their heads in when they knew they had to tighten the belt financially. And that was one year when Shane really didn't have a lot of talent at his disposal. But yeah. he had one young bloke coming through, Darren Smith.
Yes.
And I think we could tell early on he was going to be something special.
Yeah, good lad, Darren. And very good football player as well. We'll take a break now on League and More. We'll be back with Steve in a very short while to continue, and we'll have a chat about him with his thoughts on the Tigers Firehawks bid. Yeah, welcome back to League and More. I'm back with Steve Ricketts again this afternoon. Steve, I said before the break, we'll have a bit of a chat. Obviously, the Brisbane Tigers have got their Firehawks bid in. We're looking at, you know, a decision sometime down the track. I think it's in July. So your thoughts on an expansion of the NRL in Southeast Queensland?
Look, I must admit, I do worry whether we can afford another team. I don't mean financially. I would like to see another team in Brisbane. I think we should have another team in Southeast Queensland. Don't get me wrong. There should be another team here. I think 16 teams would be the ideal number. Yes. I just think we struggle to get the quality players across the board. Now, that might seem weird because, like, I think the Intrust Super Cup is a quality competition. So you would say, well, the players out of that surely can step up. But it's a quality competition because the players are quite evenly matched and you always have NRL players coming back. But if you have a look at the AFL, they always have one or two teams that are down the bottom.
Yes.
And they're just making up the numbers. And I just worry that rugby league will go down the same path. And I know Shane Richardson, who was involved with the Firehawks, has said that another team will help with, you know, state of origin yep. because Queensland only has 21% of the NRL ranks to choose from. Mm-hmm. And another team in Southeast Queensland could help in terms of participation levels. I hope that's true, but I think the elephant in the room is that a lot of the guys in the NRL are not eligible for New South Wales either.
Yes.
You know, we've allowed, our game has become very much a Polynesian game, yes. or is becoming a Polynesian game. Mm-hmm. And that's, there should be a warning sign there for the ARL Commission, the NRL, and I don't think they want to address it. You know, that the Aussie rules, they recruited Carmichael Hunt and Israel Folau, but only as promotional vehicles. They were never, ever serious about getting the Polynesian community to play Aussie rules.
Okay.
Because they do not play that game. They yeah. can't play that game because they do not have the stamina levels. They're power athletes.
Different body shapes.
Different body yep. shapes. So we have, and they're laughing their heads off, not laughing their, but they can see that rugby league, the great athletes that a lot of the Polynesian boys are, but I worry about coming through the ranks of the juniors, whether we're losing a lot of other players because they can't compete with the physical strength of the Polynesian boys. So if you get 55-60% of the NRL of Polynesian and they put their hands up first for Tonga and Samoa and whatever, you can't, as some people have said, you can't promote state yep. of origin is the best of the best.
Yep.
So there's more to it than just adding another team.
I remember coaching my children in my boys in juniors several years ago, and the same thing. The race of the Polynesians, they're obviously a physically bigger race than the Australian people. And you know, we would get the little boys, these little
boys at my sons, and Bruce Crosby was in this. Bruce Crosby's boy was in the side as well. They'd get run over by these kids, and you know, we had to keep convincing them through 12s, 13s, 14s that, you know, the more we're teaching you the right techniques and the right way to tackle in those days, you know, one down low, one over the top and so forth, and that slowly, as you build your size, you'll be able to deal with them and handle them. And that was the case. By the time we got to 15s and 16s, we were on an even par with them as well. So it's just that.
But there isn't attrition, there is an attrition rate on the way through. That's the problem.
Absolutely.
And I think weight divisions are the answer, and I think there's variations can be made to the weight divisions, because I know there are problems with that. But yeah. I grew up with weight divisions and they work fine.
Yeah, I was in that same era, mate. So, yeah. I agree. The Firehawks bid specifically, what do you know about that? What's your thoughts on that?
I've been reading quite a bit, particularly in the Courier Mail, because I still have an allegiance to the old newspaper. And, you know, look, if I had a magic wand and money was no object, I would locate a team in the Western Corridor, simply because I'm fearful that the AFL are going to get a foothold there, and that's where the population is growing, Ipswich, Western Suburbs, out to Toowoomba. I'm not saying that I believe the Jets should get the franchise.
Yes.
You know, I think the Tigers could work well because they're a cross-team town, and you've got to take into account the financial aspects, and I believe the Tigers are well-placed in that regard.
Yes.
I think the Crushers would have worked if not for the Super League war. Okay. A lot of people forget that in 95, the first year of the Crushers, their average crowd was 21,000. Mm-hmm. The Broncos in their first year, average crowd was 16,000.
Wow.
What stuffed the Broncos was, of course, Super League, because they couldn't sell season tickets. They had their sponsorships in place, but who would have foreseen that? Who would have foreseen COVID? It was just something that they couldn't manage. Redcliffe, I worry that a team on the peninsula will be too insular.
Yes.
You know, that you know, as much as they've got the financial clout, just like the Tigers have. So, you know, it wouldn't worry me which team got it.
Yep.
Location, I prefer the Western Corridor, but there's more to it than that. And Easts have been looking at this for a long time. If a lot of people would forget that in 98, when the NRL started, Easts were looking at a team then. Because the Gold Coast Chargers, they were on death's door.
Yep.
There was talk between East Tigers and the Chargers for some sort of amalgamation. So, you know, I think if you talk about groundwork, Easts are probably number one.
I think that was back in Des Morris's days as CEO here, and he was talking about the East Coast Tigers, where they'd have an affiliation with a group of like-type teams of symbols and that up and down the coast. So.
Well, they were talking to Balmain, because I think there was talk of the number of NRL clubs being cut from in Sydney, being cut from down to as low as six.
Yes, okay.
But then when Balmain heard that, okay, we're going to stay at 9 or 10, that was the end of negotiations up here, as far as I remember.
Interesting comments, mate. We're very, very pleased to have you in this afternoon. Obviously, as the journalist that you are, you can't work forever, so you're now happily entrenched in retirement, I understand. And so what's a day hold for you in retirement?
Well, a lot of old retired blokes say they're busier than ever. And in some ways it's true, because there's always things like this coming up. But also, as chairman of the Queensland Rugby League History Committee, we have a lot of projects on the go.
Yes.
We're hoping one day to get a museum at Suncorp Stadium.
Yep.
Like one of our projects, for instance, is to get recognition for guys like Johnny Payne.
Yes.
Who played here at Easts and was picked for Australia, but it's not recognised because he didn't get on the field. And where, like, his photograph hangs in the club here in his Australian jumper.
Yes.
Have a look at the Australian records. He's not there.
Okay.
So we're trying to get that fixed. There's a lot of other examples along the same lines, probably 25 to 30 over the years. And but also, I'm Brisbane Media Manager for the Men of League Foundation, which is a wonderful charity. I emcee their lunches and dinners here in Brisbane, and I also write on a voluntary basis for their magazine.
Yep.
And I've got my own website, stevericketts.com.au.
Yes.
Which I blog away madly on, and it's full of old rugby league stuff. So if you Google Gavin Payne, Steve Ricketts, there's quite a few stories come up.
Well, there might be some good ones and perhaps a couple of bad ones in there as well. We weren't all angels. I'm pleased I played in an era when there was no mobile phones and so forth. You know, it's too easy to get caught doing potentially the wrong thing at some different time. So
particularly playing with guys like Trevor Patterson and Gavin Jones and Mick McLean.
All those naughty boys. all those naughty boys. So, look, wonderful to get your thoughts and share this afternoon with us, Steve. Thank you very much for coming on board. Really appreciate it. And all the best in your retirement and those committees.
Thanks very much,
Kevin. Cheers.
How about that? Bennett Leslie still on a nudie run, and we didn't get Jayda to do a bit of TikTok, but stay tuned. League and More is what we're all about, and a great weekend of footy at Totally Workwear Stadium. Big crowds, and keep on rolling up. By this weekend, then the following weekend, the PNG Hunters will be hosting the Brisbane Tigers as we're trying to do get back on track. Hope you enjoyed our show this evening without Gavin Payne, but you had me. So, all right, see you next week.